Hello everyone, I'm going to present my topic for today, which is the adversarial attacks for deep learning models in NLP. And I'm very happy and very excited to be a part of Berlin Buzzwords 2020 again this year. So without wasting any time, let's get started. So what exactly are adversarial attacks on deep learning models in NLP? We're going to find out pretty soon. But first, going into the very deep conversation of what exactly happens in adversarial attacks in deep learning models in NLP, let us first find out what exactly are adversarial attacks. Well, adversarial attacks are basically DDoS attacks. Not just that, there are lots of attacks which intruders, hackers, hijackers, sort of try to, you know, play around with your machine learning models. Now, obviously, machine learning models take time through their learning curve to understand how exactly we can optimize any solution. This kind of, and what an adversarial attacker, you know, benefits from this is it tries to manipulate from the learning curve and change the results into something else and give us just some absurd results by confusing our model. Now we're going to find out how exactly a poor machine learning model gets confused through adversarial attacks and by adversarial attackers. So let's see who's going to train us now. As you can see, huge categories for adversarial attacks on textual data. Textual is again related to NLP. DNNs are basically deep neural networks. You can see it right here on the image which is there on the slide. Now there are various ways in how you can define the categories and how you can classify them, you know, all these adversarial attacks, how well you can, you know, structure them in various classes. So the first one, there are four for deep learning, for machine learning models, and one for deep learning models. So the first four that you see, the attack by modal access, the second one by semantic application, the third by target type, and the fourth that I mentioned, semantic granularity. All these four are for machine learning specifically, but the third one which are directly attacked to deep learning models. And we're going to find out how and what exactly happens. In modal attacks, we have two major kinds of attack, the white box and the black box, which we're going to be discussing pretty soon, but I'll give like a very brief overview. In white box attack, the intruder or the attacker has the entire information about your model, about the parameters, about the input data format, output data format, the activation function you're going to be using, everything. Everything and anything you name is known. The error function, everything is known. In black box attack, only the input format and the output format is known to the intruder, but has no idea what happens. Again, like the activation function, what kind of parameters are you using with the function, which algorithm you're going to be using, no information on that, only just info about the input and the output. So that is the modal access. The second one is the semantic application, which basically here you can see that there are two ways of doing it, in a single mode or in a cross mode method. Now single mode is that the format of the data, the mode of the data doesn't change, it remains the same. If I give you an example now, a lot of speech to text recognition, you know, applications are there, especially with chatbots and especially with virtual assistants. I think it's like one of the most basic examples I'm quoting right now, and everybody would be aware of it. So when you say something, the speech, it's an audio format. It's in an audio format, but it gets converted and it gets translated into textual data. So here, two different modes of data are being used to fetch into the machine to understand what exactly the sentence is implying and what kind of implementation we need to use. This is again cross-modal. So again, there are different modes and you're crossing them, and it's not like a hybrid, but it's somewhere how one mode gets transferred into another, and that is being used to again identify what your sentence is up to. The first mode is the single mode, where the input remains the same and the output remains the same. Let's say if I give you an example, a very basic example of, let's say, car recognition, face recognition, or vehicle recognition, something like that. The input is again an image, and the output you'll get is also a detected image. So, something like that. So that doesn't change. Could be very basic if I say classification. I mean, you have let's say if you're talking about a binary classification, so you'll give two options, and then you have those two options as your output also. There's nothing changing in the format of the input and the output. It's of the same mode. The answer might vary, but the mode may remain constant. So that's single mode. Then we have the target type. Is your model actually targeted, and targeted at which point? If not, then if it's untargeted, then maybe it's just exploration and the intruder wants to find out what exactly is happening. So that's that. And then finally, coming for the last machine learning model category of attack for the textual data, is the semantic granularity. Now, what exactly is this? Now, there could be changes, in your sentences, in your words, or even with your characters. Let's say for me, I change in a text, I'm an attacker, and I change all the G's to Q because they have the small g to small q, because obviously they are quite similar in terms of how they are being symbolized. So I change that, the meaning changes completely. I might change something at the character level, where I'm supposed to, let's say, associate at the word level. Let's say I'm supposed to associate all the day related word, let's say Wednesday, Thursday, or I was out, I was out with my friend and the day was pretty chill and cool, something like that. And I change the day to night completely. All the days in my corpus data or in my information are now be changed into night. So the meaning completely differs, and it's something different and absurd. At the sentence level, you change a lot of meanings of the sentence. So that is a change at the sentence level. So these were obviously the top four machine learning category based attacks. Now we're going to come to the deep learning neural network attack. Now there are so many attacks which we can't even name. But most importantly are the ones which happen to the CNNs and RNNs. Then comes the reinforcement. Then comes for the GANs. And finally, the hybrid models. And obviously, explaining everything right now would be too much of information. So we'll keep everything whenever it's going to be needed. So let's see what happens next in the upcoming slides. What types of these attacks are? Again, we discussed about the black and the white box attack. We discussed about the modal attacks, how they can keep changing their modes. And then we'll discuss about the attacked data set as well. These are so many types, and I've just listed some handful of them. But they're much more than this list. So don't stick to this list completely. There's a lot more which is going to come your way. Finally, coming to the white box attack. So white box attack, like I said, that the attacker has all the information of how your, what activation function you're using, what model you're going to be using, what is the input format, what is the output format. Your model is just compromised. You cannot do anything to it now. And if you see, this is a brilliant example of the white box attack. Here it says it's pretty clear that this is a legitimate input of one, and there is a lot of pre-processing and all of that is happening, and then finally you are classifying. But this one has been classified as 4. If you can see it here, it says misclassified as 4. Now, why is that a situation? That is just because here, a slide before, when you see misclassification check for, here says anything that will come your way, just name it as 4. Just classify any number as 4. Now, these kind of attacks are, since it has so much of information about your model, it's very easy to change the good aptitude of your model to give it some really, you know, absurd and sick results, and then this would degrade nothing but your model's capabilities, and obviously your hard work would be again questioned. So these kind of attacks are like, I mean, these attacks are not very general, because exposing and compromising the entire model is not very common, I would say. But if it happens, then it's a dead end. It's really, really sad. So coming to the types of these white box attacks, and there are like much more than this list, but we are just going to be sticking to these, because I mean, there is a lot more, but I'm just going to be covering the major common ones. So that's that. So the first one is the FGSM, which is basically the fast gradient sign model. And what here happens is, it quickly identifies which is a significant text in your data corpus, and it tries to change those textual items. Let's say I am talking about the president, for example. So anything related to government, anything related to party, anything related to legislation, law, bill, president, etc. These kind of words are pretty important when you're talking about the president or prime minister, whatsoever is suitable in your country. When you change these kind of words, the meaning of the entire text corpus would alter, and would, you know, it would mean completely diagrammatically opposite of what it was before. So FGSM is basically changing the textual significant items. When JSMA, it's basically Jacobian saliency, it's a really long name, matrix mapping. And it basically, you know, what it tries to do, I'll give you like a very basic hint. So whenever we use neural networks, a neural network which is generated from the preceding is the derivative of it. It's always the case. So neural network 1, neural network 2. Neural network 2 would be the derivative, it would be derived from neural network 1 as a derivative of it. And here what happens in JSMA is it tries to change the derivative values of the generated neural network layer. So N2, which was basically the generated neural network value, its values have been changed using the JSMA attack. And it not only changes the values, but the entire derivation of the information that was coming from neural network 1 to neural network 2 is now compromised. And some weird changes have been made to it, which would give you absurd results. So you cannot depend on your model, because the new neural networks that would be generating from neural network 2 as the default method of neural networks, all the information is now compromised, and there's something else only that's happening, and God knows what kind of values you're going to be generating now. Finally, we come to the direction based. Now let's say this is a little tricky one for people to understand. Let's say you are in a vector space, and I'm just suggesting the right side of yourself is pointing towards all the words which are pointing to the male. It's pointing just to the male category, and the words pointing on the left are for the female category. Now what happens is, I say that the man is handsome, makes sense. But what if I say, and what if I change, you know, that the man now is pointing towards the direction for girls, or the direction for females. It happens in word vector. In word vector, we don't have the magnitude alone, we have a direction to it. And now the man, the word, is now pointing to a direction which is for female words. So now the model would get confused, like, how can man, with being a masculine, having masculine entities and whatever, is now pointing towards the female side. So here the direction of the word keeps changing in word vectors, which creates a lot of confusion for our model. So that's again really sad. We'll come back to the summary of white box attack. Now white box attacks are, like I said, you are just compromised with everything. Your entire credibility of your machine learning model or deep learning model is just compromised. You cannot do anything to save it. If I hope it never happens, but if it does, it's really sad. So there are a lot of applications of white box attack that you can see. This text classification, then there's, like I said, text summarization. Maybe you change the meaning, like I was talking about the president one. If you want to summarize that this article is based on the president, now the significant words are changed, the FGSM or FGSM application that I suggested. So there are again like lots of applications for the white box. So yeah, so now we'll move on to the next.
So moving on, we have the black box attack, and it's very evident from the image itself that it does not know what's happening in this black box. It has like no clue. So one thing is better still with black boxes, like it does not do anything at the architecture level, but it definitely can change your input and output data. It can definitely alter your input data, and it can definitely change your output results also. So like you see here, so this image has been attacked, and then there has been a confidence, higher confidence for cat when it has been attacked, and otherwise it's an aeroplane. So you can see how changes can create an aeroplane can be assumed as a cat. So it is so different. So again, it really affects the model a lot. There are these five kinds of black box attacks. The first one is concatenation, and it's one of the most easiest kind of attack possible. Here, what exactly happens is, let's say you have a textual information already with you, and the intruder tries to add some more. It tries to append some information at the end of the text that you have. For example, if I tell you, let's say I have 3-4 sentences. My name is Sakshi. I'm an Indian. I'm staying in Delhi, for example. What if the intruder adds 3-4 lines more that India is in the South Asia. It lies in South Asia. Then Japan is not a neighboring country to India. It follows all the information regardless to my basic idea, which was talking about myself, that is Sakshi, but now it's giving all the information about India. So the model in any way would get confused and would try to focus on India rather than focusing on me. So those kind of effects can be created due to black box attacks. Then edit adversary is also similar to this. It basically what adversaries do, they sort of try to change, they try to change the meaning of the text, which is already given as an input. If I give an example of that, that might be relevant to the understanding would be, let's say I'm talking about apple. Apple is a great fruit. An apple a day keeps a doctor away. And then I start, associating apple with the Apple company. So those kind of changes falls into the edit adversary. And again, it can really drive the model crazy. And there'll be some really, really absurd and nonsensical results, which we will not be able to figure out. Then the paraphrase based adversary, I think it is very restrictive based. So what it does is it starts introducing, if you see this image right here, the diagram right here, it shows that there are some certain controlled rules introduced to the existing text information or to existing information that you have in terms of sentences. And that from that controlled information applied on your sentence, there's some paraphrase generated. For example, I have, let's say, a piece of paragraph, and I just create a rule that all of them should not have any verb maybe if I have that. So all the verbs which are basically the doing action which might help us identify the intent of the text would be vanished, would be disappeared, and then obviously there'll be incorrect outputs from that. So again, that is that. And the GAN based, it follows the same simple rule. It follows the GAN approach, and the GAN approach is basically the generative approach for all the adversarial neural networks. And in this, it's very interesting. What happens in GANs are basically it tries to generate fake samples of data, and it keeps doing it in a genetic way that every neural network, every neural layer, if I say, starts generating fake samples by visualizing the previous data, which is already fake and not of any use to our model. So that is that is that. Then substitutions are generally of two types. One is both of them follow through the recurrent neural network. Both of them are basically used for RNNs. And the two basic ideology of substitution is the generative RNNs and the substitution RNN. So in generative, it basically tries to identify most of the, basically it tries to generate like sequence-based information and tries to apply that in the input. So let's say if I give you an example for that, that will be more easy. Let's say I have XYZ as the name of a person. Then I'll just start generating some random information and start using that in the RNNs in my recurrent neural network. And in substitution, I'll start mimicking as one, me being the intruder, which is the second part of the substitution, which is the substitution neural net, RNN. It starts to mimic as one of the actual or the original or legitimate neural network RNN. It starts to imitate and mimic like that. And then it starts to create its own information and its own processing. So that really drives the model crazy. So yeah, these are some major black box attacks which really affect the model adversarially, and they are like super annoying and very difficult to find a solution for them also. Again, this is the summary, where to use, what should be used, what kind of attacks are possible for each of the attacks that we discuss. So we won't go in much detail. Now we are focusing on the multimodal attacks, and multimodal attacks are also generally, you know, having the same ideology, which I explained earlier also, that they have different modes of data. So let's say if I have a speech to text, to make it more simpler, if I have speech to text example in speech recognition on my virtual assistant, so put out a query in an audio, verbally I put out a query that I would like to know the weather forecast for today. And what if the weather word, weather, which basically, you know, resonates to the climate, is being changed to the other weather, which is weather, which basically means if, whether we do this, if we do that, you know, those kind of different, absolutely different meanings. And the model would be giving us then some third party result that we might not be even needing. Maybe they'll give us some an author recommendation, maybe, I don't know, you know, anything could be given. So it is like so difficult, and it will be so it will really, really ruin the whole essence of machine learning, I feel, if these kind of attacks become more susceptible in our environment or in our data processing. Definitely these things are possible. So these are the overall resultants that we might get, which is super scary and super frustrating. Again, I'll talk about the applications of multimodal attacks for sure, because I think these are very interesting, how we can use two different kinds of data to generate and how they might eventually land up in some different situations. So the first one is image to text. And if you remember, I showed you, and it says the optical character recognition. And I will just go back to this slide. Yeah, so this is basically an example of that we have an image here, and we are sort of generating information through text using that image. So we identify what kind of image is available on the text, and we sort of recognize it as one. So this is an example of the OCR application, which is again not the deciding it to be a four part, but just finding it to be as recognizing it to be as one. Then definitely image captioning, I already mentioned, there's an image, you find relevant text around it and you give that as a heading. Speech recognition, I think I explained before also, so it's not something I should try again and again. So these are some basic applications that can be used, which might really harm the data as well as the cost, because now everything is moved to cloud. And if something happens on the cloud, companies who are beholding all their information on cloud, I think an intruder pops in, it is one of the most scariest days of their lives. So yeah. Now, I feel a lot of people are definitely involving themselves into trying to do some new machine learning tasks like text classification, if we are talking about text in general. So I'll just keep it to text since this whole talk is about NLP, like text classification, sentiment analysis, spam detection, especially I think everybody starts from there. So these are some data sets that you should actually try with, because if you just open any random website and download any random data, could be a possibility that you might welcome an intruder and there would be some undesirable attacks made to your machine learning model, which you would not want. So definitely there's a recommendation to do these kind of research before, that whatever you're trying to do, you try to follow the legitimate data records and you go through them only, so that you have a safe data processing. So that's very important. Now, again, it's very important to know if there's a defense as such. Definitely, there are defenses. And I think the most important ones are obviously from cybersecurity. But we as data engineers or machine learning engineers or deep learning enthusiasts, what we can try is still something which is still important. The basic and the most optimized, I think, way would be definitely through cybersecurity, and it would be the best. But if whatever you can try to avoid certain things is, I think, is advisable and should be done, is the adversarial training. Now, adversarial training is a really long topic, which I would cover in the next part. But I'll definitely take over distillation for now. Distillation is a mechanism which basically applies softmax pooling at the output layer. Why we use softmax is basically we try to find as much as probability or confidence about that particular model and that for that particular data, or I mean for the entire pipeline, how much confidence our model is about this kind of information tuned in for. And I think this is when distillation is of that kind. It basically tries to identify through probabilistic methods. So one example is softmax, which is used widely, very commonly nowadays also. I think all of you might be aware of it. And I hope if you're not, you start using it. It will be very helpful in spite of not taking care of the adversarial training part also, or maybe just, being at the safer side also. If you're not doing it, that's also fine. But if you do it, other than that also, it really helps you give your deep learning models really good results also. So it's very helpful in that aspect also. And the last topic for the day would be adversarial training. There are like very common notions which I think most of you who are into machine learning would be aware of, is data augmentation. I think this is, data augmentation is like one of the most common methods in which we can scatter and identify different types and different kinds of data which our model can foresee, so that it does not have to later on while training, post-training, there would be confusions to our model. So I think during training, we should definitely incorporate all these three measures for our model to be as diverse in terms of data acceptance, in terms of regularization, in terms of optimization as possible. I think all these three are super important. So the second part to this is regularization. And I think most of you would be knowing that regularization generally often is, you know, associated to, you know, minimizing the loss function, the error of the model. So again, it will help you since you will already have like a check that how much error is your model generating and how much loss can you reduce. So that will really be helpful. And robust optimization is basically what it tries to do is, if I give you like a very brief example about it. So our model is basically, whenever we find errors, we find it in terms of maxima and minima of a convex function, and it somewhere oscillates between the maximum error generated to the minimum error generated, and it tries to identify where is the discrete point to up to which I should accept my errors, and up to a discrete point that okay, I'm okay with this much, but it's like a threshold thing, how much you can optimize your error identification function. So it's almost regarding that. So it also really, it really helps the model in identifying, okay, this much, if it is like really bad, it's this much bad, so I will not accept it at all. So it at least lets your model identify that there is something bad happening. So you can have like a better way of, you know, training your model in spite of, despite of having all these absurd results. So that helps. So that was it. Thank you so much. And I'm so happy to be a part of Berlin Buzzwords again. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Sakshi. Yeah, that's super interesting. Just checking the Slack channel. I don't see any questions so far. Guys, if you have any questions, we still have a few minutes. So please put them in the Slack channel, VBuzz2. And while we are waiting, maybe something that came to my mind, maybe a couple of things actually. So actually, it's quite interesting. And I think what you mentioned, I mean, you know, as we get more and more models into production, these things become, you know, we are not paying sufficient attention to them. I was just wondering if there is some overlap in, you know, nowadays we do, let's say, in training data when we check for bias and fairness and things like that. Because I think most of the attacks that you mentioned can be detected in the training data, if I understand your presentation. So do you have some thoughts on how we can maybe combine the two, or how do the two, let's say, methodologies differ?
Yeah, actually, they are quite different, because biases are generally an inclination towards, let's say, to a specific kind or to a specific intuition, if I put it. Let's say we talk about cars and bikes, and then I introduce aeroplane. So it's obvious that we're talking about, you know, transport within the, which are motorable and the ones which are flying. So obviously there would be some sort of identification that yes, there is an inclination for something specifically for coming talking about bias. But when I talk about adversarial attacks, it's basically the intruder is trying to create some noise and some malicious information, which is creating a lot of confusion for the model itself to identify what was the real information, because now the information has been hampered to something which is absolutely absurd. If I talk about trains and cars, now I'm talking about music and actors, you know, which is irrelevant to the conversation, I mean, to the whole idea which is happening. So that is what is, I think, the two. But definitely we can definitely tackle most of these attacks through training. Like I said, we can include data augmentation, we can definitely include regularization, and quite a few people do that also, while you know, the ones who are little experienced and they have knowledge about these things, they try to include these kind of major functions and their major steps in their pipeline, so that they don't have to face a problem later. Because once we deploy, generally now everybody is deploying their ML models on cloud, and that is really expensive. So, you know, finding a problem there would be much more expensive than finding it prior to what you have at your own reach. So those things are very important. So definitely we can try and deal with quite a few of them. But again, some of them, if we have a white box attack, finding those errors would be very difficult. Because they're at the architecture level. Yeah, thank you.
Maybe last question. So you mentioned a lot of methodologies. I mean, are there some open source toolkits or something that we can apply on the data or the models to detect some of these attacks? Is this something you see evolving, maturing?
Yeah. So there is TextFool, there is DeepFool, but they don't have they are at a very niche level. Like there are not a very I would say that they are not they're not made for really large data sets or something like that. They're at a very small and niche level. So for small data sets and for small trivial problems, you can definitely reach out to them. But for higher ones, I think an integration with cybersecurity would definitely help. So those two are still possible to use them.
So maybe last question. So there's a question from Peter. He's basically asking, so adversarial attacks could literally destroy companies or organizations. Can you give a recent real life example of such damage by breaking a company's model? So do you have any real life examples of some of the attacks you mentioned?
Yeah, actually companies don't reveal these kind of things because they don't want their image to go down. So if they have any intrusive attacks, they don't try to make this, they don't publicly announce this because it's kind of not a very good measure on their path. So I'm not sure about, I'm sure there might be cases with quite a few companies that hackers must have definitely tried to attack them, but companies don't reveal them. So I have like no clue about it. But it's definitely possible that quite a few of them might be, you know, in such situations.
Yeah, sure. And I guess we are a bit in the early stages of, you know, we have started to put things in production now. So I think we will see more and more of them in the future.